So you've made the leap. You've decided to pursue your passion and call yourself an artist, and you finally made your big debut on Instagram, YouTube, your blog, Etsy, and... congratulations. Welcome to the artist life. So a little bit about me. I've basically been an artist, creative, since graduating college in 2007. In 2012, I achieved my dream of becoming a TV commercial director. But in 2014, I realized I hated it and I quit my job to travel the world and find a new direction in life. I've had some incredible experiences, but also so many challenges, and I wanted to share some of what I've learned with you because I've needed advice so much to keep going on this path because I had no idea how hard it was gonna be. So I wanna start off this series by sharing this book I have on Kindle. It's called Real Artists Don't Starve by Jeff Goins. In this book, he really begins by trying to dispel this notion of the starving artist, that it's a myth, it's something that we've accepted as kind of a cultural stereotype, but isn't necessarily true. The first step in letting go of the starving artist mentality is to let go of who we think we are or must be, even if we have no idea what new identity awaits us. What's out there, however scary as it may be, is almost certainly better than staying where we are now. It's never too late to become who you are, taking small steps along the way. Now, when I quit in 2014, I was really scared. And 4 years later, honestly, I am still struggling a lot. But I still believe that I made the right long-term move because I feel like what I would have gained by staying there is far, far outweighed by what I'm gaining, really exploring what else I could be that could make me so much happier than this. Especially if you're an artist, you have to find out who you are. And if you never change course, you'll never know who you could be. From chapter 3, Apprentice Under a Master. Creative success, he says, is far more often the result of hard work and perseverance rather than luck or big breaks. Starving artists wait for their big breaks. Thriving artists become apprentices in their crafts. My mentors, I owe them so much for teaching me, for talking me through the most difficult parts. I always fear that if you become successful too soon and you suddenly internalize all that pride that you're hot shit, there's just so much you won't learn, you won't be humble enough, or you'll be treated as a superstar and you won't be able to apprentice with masters, with people who've literally been doing what you want to do for decades and have seen all the struggles. So the question is, how do you become an apprentice, or how do you find a mentor? The marks of a good apprentice are patience, perseverance, and humility. This attitude will earn the attention of masters who will want to invest in you and see you succeed. Not only does an apprentice not give up, they do what no one else is willing to do. The moment we begin to believe we deserve success is the very moment it will elude us. Check your privilege. Especially in the beginning, swallow your pride and just focus on being as good as you can be. From chapter 4, Harness Your Stubbornness. What often allows great work to get the attention it deserves is not a matter of only talent or luck, but a matter of the will. Can you stick around long enough to see your work succeed? Do you have enough grit to take a few critical hits and keep going? Or will you get discouraged at the first sign of failure? I think many of us, especially those of us who come from more privileged upbringings, we don't realize the amount of rejection, disappointment that's mandatory in becoming successful in any field. You have to question whether you really want this or you just like the idea of being an artist. If you're not willing to put in your reps, maybe don't bother, because 5 times is not enough. 10 times is not enough. We're talking hundreds of times over years. From chapter 5, Cultivate Patrons, and here he talks about that ever thorny question of whether you should quit your day job. Do you quit your job and try to strike out on your own? Not at all. Surprise. You look around for the closest patron, even if that means your day job, because any job can be a means to making your art if you have the right perspective. Employers become patrons when we begin to see them not as obstacles to the work we want to do, but as a way of funding it. many, many times since I quit my job as a commercial director, I have questioned myself whether I could not just have put up with it more. I made my choice and I'm trying to figure it out, but I'm just saying, if you can put up with your job, you have to treat your job as your patron to keep making money so you can keep making art, and never, especially in the beginning, burden your art with the duty of making money, because that's just, it's the opposite of what you need to create great, unique work that's true to you. From chapter 8, practice in public. There is no better way to improve than to put your work out there. No other way to get discovered than to risk rejection. Like we said earlier, if you don't have the guts to get rejected, and I'm still working on this. I mean, I'm terrified at least like putting myself on YouTube like this. This was in a book. You can't keep out the bad without keeping out the good. So you have to practice in public, keep generating work. And what that does is, he says, when we sincerely offer our gifts to the world, not through hype, but by practicing in public, the world often repays us by first taking notice and then responding with loyalty. This is why many artists have like daily projects, because they force themselves to get those reps in, those reps I was talking about. Many times, this is exactly what it takes to get noticed. And there's so many examples of this online. He says in chapter 9, called Don't Work for Free, our best work comes from the tension of trying to serve our craft and meet the demands of the market. This is the world we live in. Charles Dickens did some of his best work while serializing his stories to pay the bills. Money and art, we need them both. Some artists tend to think making money is either a system you sell out to or something to be avoided altogether, but in reality, it's neither. We must seek to better understand the business of being an artist. Ignoring this reality is the fastest route to stop creating altogether. To be an artist is to be an entrepreneur. Now I know many of you will hate hearing this, but the truth is, if you want to be an independent artist, you have to take responsibility. You will be the primary person responsible for keeping your career as an artist running. And now from chapter 12, money is the means to making art, but it must never be its master. He quotes Professor Lewis Hyde, I believe that young people coming up may take 10 years to find out if they can do that work and make a living at it and find an audience. There's an in-between period of trying to get established, and during that period, young artists need support from their communities where they can lead dignified lives without becoming poor. It takes a lot of time, and you have to find any way you can. You have to take responsibility for this, for finding ways to make the money that allows you to make good art, that allows you to learn, to practice, and to explore new ideas. And finally, he says, this is what most of us want, not to get rich off our creations, but to have enough time and freedom to create what we want. We want to have the means to focus on what matters to us. Wealth used to mean being able to buy a big house or buy a sports car. But I think in 2018, for many of us, what wealth means is freedom and options. And if you have all the money in the world, but you don't have the freedom to live the life you want, what's the point? If we reorient our attitude to money, to not to making X amount of money, but just to being able to live a lifestyle where you are free to create and do what you want, maybe that'll make things a little bit easier. For some parting words, there's always a way for the person who is tenacious enough to find one. You just have to search for one and diligently treat your art as more than a frill, as a duty. So I really encourage you to click the link down below to get a copy of the book. Share with me in the comments what were your favorite pieces of advice or what you're learning on your own journey as an artist to try to find success in making your art self-sustaining. And I'd love for this to begin to be a community where we can have healthy, supportive discussions. And if this was helpful to you, please do help me out by liking and subscribing, even clicking the bell for notifications. And I will see you next week with more from the artist's life.